The Stolen Child by W. B. Yeats. Where dips the rocky highland of Sleuth Wood in the lake, there lies a leafy island where flapping herons wake the drowsy water rats. There we've hid our fairy vats full of berries and of reddest stolen cherries. Come away, O human child, to the waters and the wild, with a fairy hand in hand, for the world's more full of weeping than you can understand. Where the wave of moonlight glosses the dim grey sands with light, far off by furthest Rosses, we footed all the night, weaving olden dances, mingling hands and mingling glances, till the moon has taken flight. To and fro we leap and chase the frothy bubbles, while the world is full of troubles and is anxious in its sleep. Come away, O human child, to the waters and the wild, with a fairy hand in hand, for the world's more full of weeping than you can understand. Where the wandering water gushes from the hills above Glencar, in pools among the rushes that scarce could bathe a star, we seek for slumbering trout, and whispering in their ears give them unquiet dreams, leaning softly out from ferns that drop their tears over the young streams. Come away, O human child, to the waters and the wild, with a fairy hand in hand, for the world's more full of weeping than you can understand. Away with us he's going, the solemn-eyed, he'll hear no more the lowing of the calves on the warm hillside, or the kettle on the hob sing peace into his breast, or see the brown mice bob round and round the oatmeal chest. For he comes, the human child, to the waters and the wild, with a fairy hand in hand, for the world's more full of weeping and he can understand. Among school children. I walk through the long schoolroom questioning. A kind old nun in a white hood replies. The children learn to cipher and to sing, to study reading books and history, to cut and sew, be neat in everything. In the best modern way, the children's eyes in momentary wonder stare upon a 60-year-old smiling public man. I dream of a Ladin body bent above a sinking fire, a tale that she told of a harsh reproof or trivial event that changed some childish day to tragedy, told and it seemed that our two natures blent into a sphere from youthful sympathy, or else to alter Plato's parable into the yolk and white of the one shell. And thinking of that fit of grief or rage, I look upon one child or t'other there, and wonder if she stood so at that age, for even daughters of the swan can share something of every paddler's heritage. And had that colour upon cheek or hair, and thereupon my heart is driven wild, she stands before me as a living child. Her present image floats into the mind, that quattrocento finger fashionate, hollow of cheek, as though it drank the wind and took a mess of shadows for its meat, and I, though never of Ladin kind, had pretty plumage once, enough of that, better to smile on all that smile and show there is a comfortable kind of old scarecrow. What youthful mother, a shape upon her lap, honey of generation had betrayed, and that must sleep, shriek, struggle to escape, as recollection or the drug decide, would think her son, did she but see that shape with 60 or more winters on its head, a compensation for the pang of his birth, or the uncertainty of his setting forth. Plato thought nature but a spume that plays upon a ghostly paradigm of things. Solider Aristotle played the tawse upon the bottom of a king of kings. World-famous golden-thighed Pythagoras fingered upon a fiddlestick or strings. What a star sang and careless muses heard. Old clothes upon old sticks to scare a bird. Both nuns and mothers worship images, but those the candles light are not as those that animate a mother's reveries, but keep a marble or a bronze repose. And yet they too break hearts, O presences that passion, piety, or affection knows, and that all heavenly glory symbolize, O self-born mockers of man's enterprise. Labor is blossoming or dancing where the body is not bruised to pleasure soul, nor beauty born out of its own despair, nor blear-eyed wisdom out of midnight oil. O chestnut tree, great-rooted blossomer, are you the leaf, the blossom, or the bowl? O body swayed to music, O brightening glance, how can we know the dancer from the dance? The wild swans at Cool. The trees are in their autumn beauty. The woodland paths are dry. Under the October twilight, the water mirrors a still sky. Upon the brimming water among the stones are 59 swans. The 19th autumn has come upon me since I first made my count. I saw, before I had well finished, all suddenly mount and scatter, wheeling in great broken rings upon their clamorous wings. I have looked upon those brilliant creatures, and now my heart is sore. All's changed since I, hearing at twilight, the first time on this shore, the bell beat of their wings above my head, trod with a lighter tread. Unwearied still, lover by lover, they paddle in the cold. Companionable streams or climb the air, their hearts have not grown old. Passion or conquest, wander where they will, attend upon them still. But now they drift on the still water, mysterious, beautiful. Among what rushes will they build, by what lake's edge or pool? Delight men's eyes when I wake some day to find that they have flown away. When you are old. When you are old and grey and full of sleep and nodding by the fire, take down this book and slowly read and dream of this soft look your eyes had once and of their shadows deep. How many loved your moments of glad grace, and loved your beauty with love false or true, but one man loved the pilgrim soul in you, and loved the sorrows of your changing face. And bending down beside the glowing bars, murmur a little sadly how love fled, and paced upon the mountains overhead, and hid his face amid a crowd of stars. The Lake of Innisfree. I will arise and go now, and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee-loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the fields of the morning to where the cricket sings. There midnight's all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and a day, I hear lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore, while I stand on the roadway, or on the pavement's grey, I hear it in the deep heart's core. He wishes for the cloths of heaven. Had I the heaven's embroidered cloths, inwrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half-light, I would spread the cloths under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams.